Is there any openness at all? Is there any openness at all, or would you compare it to be better than the United States? Because the United States, like Mexico, is very open about it, and other countries around the world. I'm just wondering if Canada has any, you know, is it, would you compare them, or
I don't think it can compare them.
Really?
No, I don't.
Yeah, okay.
I don't even know how much information we have, if any.
Okay.
I don't think we're very much in the loop anymore. I think we probably were in the loop more in the 1950s.
Oh, okay.
Than we are now, but that's just my guess.
Yeah.
And I may spend a little time in the next year or so trying to find out what's going on, but I haven't had time. I was writing the book and been doing other things.
Well, your message is very important.
Yeah. Yeah.
I understand that in 1960 you inaugurated a UFO landing pad in St. Paul in Alberta, Canada. Can
yeah.
you well, tell us about that? Because in fact, if I may read this post-it sign beside the pad, and it reads like this: the area under the world's first UFO landing pad was designated international by the town of St. Paul as a symbol of our faith that mankind will maintain the outer universe free from national wars and strife, that future travel in space will be safe for all intergalactic beings. All visitors from Earth or otherwise are welcome to this territory and to the town of St. Paul. So what was it like for you, and how did it all come about?
Well, that sounds great to me now. I'd like to be able to write that.
Yeah.
It's beautifully written,
yeah.
And I don't think I was even aware of it. I probably read it at the time, but actually, it's a long time ago,
yeah.
And I don't really think I took the whole thing seriously.
I want to ask you about that.
No,
yeah.
This was our centennial year.
Okay.
And senior ministers, of which I was one, were invited to go across the country and help celebrate the centennial.
Yeah, okay.
And so this little bilingual town in northern Alberta got in touch with me, and they were so persuasive.
Mm-hmm.
And they were doing more projects. They did more projects for the centennial than any other town in Canada or city.
So everything was covered, yeah.
Everything was covered, yeah.
Even UFOs.
And even the UFOs. So I said, sure, well, why don't I go out there? So I got an airplane and flew out and participated in their ceremony. Had a
right.
wonderful day with them. They're
right.
they're just wonderful people.
Okay.
Just sound like something they would write. And
yeah.
I had a wonderful day with them.
Okay.
But
you didn't read the pad. You didn't read the sign of those.
Well, I probably read it, but it would have gone in one knot hole, not the other,
yeah.
probably,
yeah.
at the time. But you know, looking back,
yeah.
I take it with greater seriousness than I would have at the time.
You know, also, in 2005, you accused the President George Bush at the time of plotting an intergalactic war. And I wanted to ask you about that. I think, I have a quote here. I believe it says, the United States military are preparing weapons which could be used against the aliens, and they could get us into an intergalactic war without us ever having any warning. The Bush administration has finally agreed to let the military build a forward base on the moon, and which will put them in a better position to keep track of the goings and comings of the visitors from space and to shoot at them if they so decide.
Yeah, well, I want to deny the quote
you used. Okay, good. I wanted to make sure.
Right.
I'm just...
But most of the rest is correct.
Okay.
That they, in my opinion, have been developing
just
weapons.
The basic of it, right.
Yeah, they've been developing weapons that are, in my opinion, designed to... deal with extraterrestrials. Mm-hmm. They've certainly been designing tracking ways of finding out where they're going and
mm-hmm.
when they're coming and going and all of that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think even though the Army had been trying to get a base on the moon for years,
mm-hmm.
I think that President Bush finally gave permission for them to start going ahead with it.
Right, right.
And so this is really just kind of routine if you get into the military
right.
orbit.
Yes.
Of what was going on, because mm-hmm. they have taken this whole phenomenon very seriously.
Right. Yes.
And General Twining designated them as enemy aliens
mm-hmm.
right from the beginning.
Exactly.
And
yes.
I don't know that designation has ever been withdrawn.
Mm-hmm. Right. I don't think it has.
I think it's a good thing we should try and find out.
Yes.
Ask Secretary Gates if
yes.
anybody has ever withdrawn it, and if so,
yes.
when was it done?
Mm-hmm.
I think it still applies.
Yeah.
And what some of us fear, of course, knowing General Eisenhower's reservation about the people into whose hands all of this technology fell, that it might be just used as an excuse for spending another few hundred billion dollars of the taxpayers' money,
mm-hmm.
providing lots of promotions for generals and more business for the for the industrial industries that support the war machine.
Yep.
So they have a motive for doing all of this, mm-hmm. which they say, oh, well, we're concerned. Maybe there are some friendly people up there, but maybe there are some that aren't so friendly, and mm-hmm. and we can't take a chance, so we've got to have all this stuff ready in case they should start shooting at us. Mm-hmm. Well, if you go back in the history of the last 60 years, mm-hmm. we're the ones that have started all the shooting.
Yes.
And sure, they have retaliated in a few cases, and I think any fair person would say, well, if you shoot at me, my life's in danger, I may want to take a crack back at you, just rather than just saying, you know, kill me, my life's done, or whatever.
Yeah.
So, but all of the initiative, the hostile initiative, has been on our part,
right.
rather than vice versa.
Yes.
So I think this is something that has to be examined very closely.
Yeah.
And as part of the disclosure process, I would like to see that come out. And I would like to see people cross-examined under oath mm-hmm. who say, well, there's a real threat. Because, you know, why do you say that? Mm-hmm. How many times have you been subject to attack? And were they provoked?
Mm-hmm.
And could you give us information to prove that that is so?
Mm-hmm.
And not just speculation, which would be good for maybe your purposes, which may not be in the best interest of the United States or in the world. So it's a toughie. And I like Carol Rosen's presentation to the Congress, and it is realistic. There's going to be expiration. You can't stop the military from trying to fly to wherever they're trying to fly to, and don't really want to, but you don't want them to take off saying, well, we're armed to the teeth, and the first person that even looks at us sideways, we're going to shoot first and ask questions afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
Because that is exactly what's been wrong with the world for thousands of years.
Yeah.
And we don't want to say, well, okay, well, let's extend our barbarism
mm-hmm.
to other parts of the galaxy, mm-hmm. see? And so I think it's something we really have to dig into.
I think it's fantastic that you're part of that. That's really wonderful. You know, I'm curious about you mentioned seeing a report by Peter Jennings on the subject, and tell me about that and how that came about.
The ABC did a two-hour special.
Yeah, right.
And he was a Canadian, and...
Right, that's right.
And a friend of mine was the one who told me... Actually, the friend was the same guy that sent me the book, and he insisted that I watch this special because I was busy at the time, and I usually said he'd send me a lot of stuff, and I said, well, I haven't got time to read it, and just pile it up.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he was counting on me to get more and more involved as time went on, and finally his faith paid off, and I proved to be what he had hoped for.
Oh.
He picked me really to because he thought I would be fair and just in my decisions and in my judgments, and so he was the one that got me interested. And I watched that, and I could see the wobbling back and forth mm-hmm. because the skepticism, the reality. But you watch all these ex-policemen
mm-hmm.
and pilots
right.
and military pilots say, hey, I've seen one of those things. And you say, are these people all liars?
Mm-hmm.
And maybe one or two, I don't know if one or two are or not, but I don't know how you could, ABC would put together a two-hour show
mm-hmm.
and only pick out liars.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So
I wanted the same thing.
So I said to myself, "Hey, these guys are telling the truth."
Right.
And so there's got to be something. There's got to be something to this.
That's interesting. You know, also there was something about Stephen Hawkins commenting on ETs. That I think you had a comment on that said that though most extra. This is Stephen Hawking's quote. Though most extraterrestrial life could be only in the form of small animals. There could be also nomads looking to conquer and colonize other worlds. What was your reaction to that statement?
Well, I really, to be truthful, thought it was irresponsible.
Right, right.
Here's a great scientist who obviously isn't up to date on what's going on in the world, and portraying a picture that was so far from reality.
Yeah.
It was just the reality of his imagination that it was highly misleading. And consequently, I thought it was irresponsible, and I said so.
Right.
And I would say so again. If I was talking to him, I would say the same thing. I really am interested in these scientists who are saying, we've got to find a planet out there which will sustain life.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, why don't you go talk to your own government. They can give you a list of them.
How do you handle your critics or disbelievers in the whole UFO thing? Like, they'll tell you that's a bunch of bunk. How do you deal with that? You know, because they're misinformed. They haven't done that research at all.
I've got one today, and I was just figuring out whether I was going to give them an impolite reply or polite.
Yeah.
But I've decided on the polite.
Yeah.
And say that he's really proving the point. He said, you know, how could the government keep it quiet all these years? And I'm going to say, you know, in a very nice way, that you're providing proof that they've been able to, and then give them the URLs of some of the speakers from the Congress and say, don't take my word for it. Go and see some of the stuff that these guys have accumulated and see what you think of it.
You know, I'd like to flesh out, if we could, just that one chapter that you have. And I understand, I really appreciate your approach with your book and trying to create a mainstream bridge to the issues at hand, the important issues, which of course is our environment, our economy. And you have that, you slid that little UFO chapter. And I'd like to explore and flesh out what that chapter said. I haven't read your book, sir, but what did you speak about in that chapter, and what was your intention?
Mostly I just went through my experience, mm-hmm. and then my interviews mm-hmm. with these people that we were just talking about mm-hmm. and others, mm-hmm. and then some conclusions mm-hmm. as to how many species there might be that we've identified already, mm-hmm. what the ships look like, the variety from the small foo-foo fighters up to mm-hmm. allegedly motherships mile wide, and some.
Wow, that's a chapter. That's a great chapter, Paul.
Yeah, it's a good primer.
Yeah, it is.
And that's what it's designed for, is to say.
Yeah. Well, a little teaser.
And yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And a lot of my friends who have read it have been influenced because they trust me.
Right.
And they say, hey, if you're saying this, maybe there's something to it.
Yeah.
And this is the way it was intended. It's not a book on UFOs,
right.
but it's a book that gets people, I hope, a little bit interested. Mm-hmm. And maybe saying, well, if Heather says so, it could be so, or maybe it is so, depending on how well they know me.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, it has the relation that I draw, of course, between the reverse engineering and the possibility of using it to save the planet.
Mm-hmm.
And so it ties into the book. It's all part of a whole, comes together. But it's mostly a primer to get people interested.
When you mention different species, how many species do you think it is? What did you write?
Well, I don't know. When I had Ed Mitchell, Apollo astronaut, for dinner one night, and we were bantering back and forth, and he said, how many species do you think there are? And I said, well, somewhere between two and a dozen. He said, yeah, that's what I think, too.
Really?
I think I list six in my book.
Yeah, you have six in your book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I have since learned about the tall whites,
right.
Which I was unfamiliar with before, mm-hmm. but I had a long chat with somebody who had worked there and mm-hmm. who got to know them and to trust mm-hmm. them and vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
And told me a lot about them, and I'll be mentioning those very briefly my address here.
Well, what a fantastic vision for our planet and our world. Thank you, Paul Hellyer, for all your work and efforts and what you're doing, and we're just so thankful for you.